Assalamu alaikum. Bismillah. Bismillah. Alhamdulillahi na'maduhu wa nasta'inuhu wa nastaghfiruhu wa na'udhu billahi min shururi anfusina wa min sayyiati a'malina. Man yahdihillahu fala mudilla lahu wa man yudlilhu fala hadiya lahu. Wa ashhadu an la ilaha illallah wahdahu la sharika lahu wa ashhadu anna Muhammadan 'abduhu wa rasuluhu sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. يا أيها الذين آمنوا اتقوا الله حق تقاته ولا تموتن إلا وأنتم مسلمون يا أيها الناس اتقوا ربكم الذي خلقكم من نفس واحدة وخلق منها زوجها وبث منهما رجالا كثيرا ونساء واتقوا الله الذي تساءلون به والأرحام إن الله كان عليكم رقيبا يا أيها الذين آمنوا اتقوا الله وقولوا قولا سديدا يصلح لكم أعمالكم ويغفر لكم ذنوبكم ومن يطع الله ورسوله فقد فاز فوزا عظيما أما بعد. All praise be to Allah from whom we seek help and forgiveness. We seek refuge with Allah from the evil of our own souls and from our own bad deeds. Whomsoever Allah guides will never be led astray, and whomsoever Allah leads astray, no one can guide. I bear witness that there is no God but Allah, the One, having no partner. And I bear witness that Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam is Allah's servant and messenger. O ye who believe, be mindful of Allah in the way Allah deserves, and do not die except in a state of full submission to Allah. O humanity, be mindful of your Creator, who created you from a single soul and from it created its mate, and through both spread countless men and women. And be mindful of Allah, in whose name you appeal to one another, and honor your ties of kinship. Surely Allah is ever watchful over you. O ye who believe, be mindful of Allah and say what is right. Allah will bless your deeds for you and forgive your sins. And whoever obeys Allah and the Messenger of Allah has truly achieved a great triumph. Since the start of the COVID-19 pandemic, the one thing that has been exponentially increasing besides the number of cases in the United States has been the number of hours people have been streaming TV shows and movies and subscribing to services such as Netflix, Hulu, and Disney Plus at a record rate. Not to be outdone amidst this craze, I too decided to invest in a 30-day free trial of Netflix with a school email account that was set to expire in exactly 30 days anyway. What was there to lose? As I browsed through the Netflix library for the first time in many years, my attention was caught at what appeared to be a fairly extensive selection of Bollywood cinema. Being a part of the South Asian diaspora, naturally, my curiosity was piqued. It was then that my eye came across one film in particular, which I hadn't seen in nearly 15 years, yet one that was among my all-time favorites, Lagan. Many of us may have probably already watched this 3-hour and 45-minute classic at least one or two times in our lives, and others of us may just be familiar with it. Nevertheless, I must give a spoiler alert in case you were still wanting to see it and just hadn't had a chance in the near 20 years that it's been out. To sum it up briefly, Lagan is a story set in late 19th century India under the British Raj, in the village of Champaner, located in western India. The word Lagan itself means tax or tribute, which was paid by villagers to their ruling princely states or maharajas, and subsequently to the occupying British Empire itself, and is the central topic of the film, which discusses the plight of a village struggling to yield a harvest and subsequently pay their agricultural tax through a drought. In seeking permission from their maharaja to grant them a forbearance on Lagan for the year, they are instead offered a bet by the supervising officer of the British cantonment in Champaner, Captain Russell. Russell agrees to not only cancel the tax for this year, but to do so for the next 3 years, and for the entire province at that. Only on one condition, though, that the villagers beat the British officers in a game of cricket. Russell makes this most unusual wager, having been offended by the remark of one of the villagers, the titular character, Bhuvan, who called the game child's play. If the villagers lost, however, the stipulation was that they would in turn pay 3 times their tax amount, something which was akin to a death sentence given their dire situation. In the face of these odds, the overwhelming pressure by his fellow villagers to capitulate and decline the offer, Bhuvan unabashedly accepted the offer, to the horror of the villagers and to the pleasure of Captain Russell and his fellow officers. The story then focuses on the character of Bhuvan, who has drawn the ire of most of the villagers because of his stance, yet works against all odds to put together a motley crew of sorts of a team, a mix of those who have believed in Bhuvan from the beginning, as well as those who doubted and antagonized him at first, eventually with all coming together not only to play, but to beat the British team and free the entire province from taxation for the next 3 years. I'm not sure if it was just coincidence or impeccable timing, but just a few weeks before I watched Lagan, I completed a course at Hartford Seminary as part of my Islamic chaplaincy program on the biography of the Prophet Muhammad Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam, and how this biography provided a model for pastoral care, praxis, and grassroots leadership and change within our community. As I watched Lagan, I had to double check myself on the parallels I was starting to see. When Bhuvan seized an opportunity to stand up against the injustice of his people's oppressors in hopes of liberation for not just him and his family, but his fellow countrymen, I started to see this not just as some Bollywood sports movie, but something with a deeper, more parallel message of what I had just encountered a few weeks prior in my class. Beyond the message, the exoteric elements also began to overlap. What did this Bollywood movie really have in terms of similarities to that of the prophetic biography? At the onset of Bhuvan's actions, he was instantly condemned by all or a majority of the villagers, even having his life threatened by the villagers of other provinces or of other parts of the province who had heard of the news of his actions. When the Prophet Muhammad first brought his message, he too was ridiculed by his fellow tribesmen and townspeople, called Majnun, and thought to be someone whose message would bring calamity upon his town and the tribe as a whole, and was even harassed and nearly killed by these same individuals. In Lagan, the first person to express their support for Bhuvan was his friend Gori, a sincere girl who knows the innate goodness of Bhuvan and believes in his cause. The first person to comfort and support the Prophet ﷺ after he was charged with his duty by Jibril alayhi salam was a woman as well, his wife Khadija radiallahu anha. The first male to support Bhuvan in his plan to assemble a team and to take his call to action to the village was a child, Tipu. The first male to pledge his support for the Prophet Muhammad Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam and who also stood by him when he attempted to recruit the leaders and elders of his tribe in his own home was his cousin Ali, who at the time was also a child. The people to join Bhuvan's team were not those individuals who were most well off, but rather those individuals who were at the margins and had the least to lose. They were at the peripheries of the village, including a man who was mute, another man who was perceived by villagers as a madman, and a man who was someone deemed as untouchable or had a severe deformity and was untouchable, deemed as such by the entire society. Yet in time, the individuals who were deemed fit, landowning and able, joined too upon seeing the strides this most unorthodox team began to make. The Prophet's community was not made up of the most able-bodied individuals or those who were at the highest rung of society either. When asked who followed him, a townsperson remarked that his followers were orphans, children, slaves, freed slaves, widows, and other individuals at the margins. Alongside these individuals at the periphery came those whom the Meccan society deemed both able-bodied and economically influential, such as those of Abdurrahman ibn Auf or Umar ibn al-Khattab. Bhuvan was joined as well by a villager who pretended to want to play for his team, yet was revealed to actually have loyalty to the British and sought Bhuvan's downfall. The Prophet ﷺ too had individuals who came to him appearing to be sincere in joining his cause, yet would do their best behind his back to undermine him and see him fail in any endeavors, namely the Munafiqun led by Abdullah ibn Ubay ibn Salud. Beyond the sheer manpower that followed the assembly of the team, the glue that kept the team together was Bhuvan, who in being the leader of the team knew that this was a fight for which he could not win alone, and one that required him to befriend and ally with all who were in his village, especially those who were antagonistic against him. He never refused anyone from the team, even the villager who committed treachery against them. and he lifted up the unique abilities of each member of his team, which may otherwise have been overlooked given the circumstances in which they lived. He highlighted the strength of a team member who spent his life beating a drum for the mandir despite having no voice. He identified the agility which was required of a wicketkeeper in a man who was an ordinary chicken farmer. And he raised up the crippled hand of a man who was deemed untouchable and called it the team's greatest strength. He did all of these and more because he knew that it took more than just sticks and stones and muffled grumbling to fight back against the injustices of the British overlords. He knew that it required a collective organization and holistic uplifting, which brought together all of these unique pieces into a fist, united and unbreakable. Similarly, the Prophet ﷺ was the glue that kept his community together in times of persecution, as well as in times of sovereignty in Medina. He too utilized and foregrounded the abilities of his Sahaba where others or even they themselves may have overlooked. In a freed Abyssinian slave and a blind man, he found the voices that would call his community to prayer. In men and women of tribes seen as lesser or weaker, he found his greatest strengths. And under the feet of mothers, he instructed a society rooted in patriarchy and hypermasculinity to find paradise. I want to clarify that I'm in no way trying to attempt to hold the fictional character of Bhuvan to the likes or stature of the Prophet Muhammad ﷺ, nor am I implying that the makers of this film used the seerah of the Prophet ﷺ to craft a sports drama set in 19th century India. They may have, and that's all fine and dandy, but that's not what I want to get at here. What I want to lift up and what I want to challenge is our notion of the sunnah and how we strive to uphold it, especially in the times in which we live. Oftentimes, we've reduced the sunnah to mere gestures, mannerisms, or other performative actions devoid of any essence or substance. We often restrict or limit it as something we can only find within our sources, our examples, our traditions, and restrict other outlets that may give us reflections of prophetic action, both past and contemporary. Do we forget that prior to his birth, the mother of our beloved Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam saw a dream in which a light emerged from her womb that not only lit up Arabia, but the entire world? This is why I opened up an Islamic gathering with a discussion of a Bollywood film, highlighting resistance, justice, and the importance of collective organization and solidarity against oppression, because these values are universal. These values are prophetic, and these values are sunnah. Yet we need not to only narrow it to ourselves in trying to sift and find them through only Muslim contexts, but open our eyes to see the universality of them and their existence in the world around us. Lagan simply gives us a visual into what organizing against all odds looks like. It helps us imagine what it looks like to go against the grain, even when you are disadvantaged and outmatched by the systems and structures of power that are keeping you down. It helps us see what it looks like to cooperate and organize with those whom you, as well as society at large, may have chosen to ignore or brush aside. But we need to not just go to Lagan or to other films and movies we can easily access from our homes and devices to see this. Lagan simply gives us a 21st century live action depiction of a similar struggle in essence and principle, which took place 1400 years earlier that most of us grew up learning about, yet never read into, particularly when it is most relevant and pertinent in our time today. We currently are living in a watershed moment in our nation's history. As a people, we are standing at the precipice of something truly extraordinary. This year alone, from the murders of George Floyd, Ahmaud Arbery, Breonna Taylor, and most recently the shooting of Joseph Blake, among others, a significant portion of our society seems to have woken up to the deep issues of racial injustice, police brutality, white supremacy, and systemic and institutionalized racism plaguing our society. As Muslims, the difficult part for many of us, especially those of us from non-Black immigrant communities, hasn't been an issue of participating in protests or sharing our solidarity via social media. Rather, the most difficult part has seemed to be taking this message into our own communities and our own mosques and our own families, where these same injustices and prejudice and racialized sentiments have been incubating for years and having these difficult conversations, being the agents of change even, and especially if it is against those whom we love most. We have been wrestling and we continue to wrestle with this and how we can carry this out. For some of us, this isn't an issue. Confrontation is in our identity. Shout out to my Arab brothers and sisters. But for others of us who have grown up and lived much of our lives with our heads down due to various insecurities with our identities or our dynamics at home, this feels like an entirely insurmountable task. In all honesty, I don't have an answer for this or how we can accomplish this. But I know that our current state of affairs will not be changed until we first change ourselves. That indeed, Allah will not change the condition of a people until they change what is within themselves first. And I know that no matter how heavy or burdensome this task may feel, we are never alone in it. I am reassured. I am reassured and I feel supported when I see that the Quran reminds us in Surah An-Nisa that in this sojourn for justice, Allah is our personal guide, saying, Ya ayyuha alladhina amanu kunu qawwamina bilqisti shuhada lillahi walau ala anfusikum awil walidaini wal aqrabin. That, O ye who have believed, be custodians of and persistently standing firm in justice, witnesses for Allah. Witnesses for Allah, even if it may be against yourselves or your parents or your relatives. I am reassured when I know that this faith I hold nearer and dearer to me than anything else in this world wouldn't have been made possible had such sacrifices not been made by individuals who may not have been all that different from us. And I am assured and reassured when I look back into the seerah of the Prophet ﷺ and saw that this struggle was not taken up alone, nor was it one of fiction. Rather, what we see in the seerah and what we saw in the seerah and dramatized in another essence through Lagan is how effective mobilization can and will happen, no matter the odds, when we ourselves approach a task and challenge with sincerity and an open heart. There is no doubt that there are certain individuals in our lives or types of people whom we may want to keep our distance from, let alone join hands with. Yet, what the seerah of the Prophet ﷺ shows us is that it is not always about us who feel that we are the sole bearers of a heavy message, but also about those who are around us. What would the life and struggle of the Prophet ﷺ have been like had Khadija not been there to embrace him and comfort him when he first received revelation from Jibreel alayhi salam and doubted himself? What would his life have been like had Abu Talib or Mutim ibn Adi not given him protection against the threat of his own tribesmen? What would his life have been like had friends of his like Abu Bakr radiallahu anh not taken the beating of a mob for him? Or if Ali radiallahu anh hadn't slept in his place so that he may escape the swords of his tribesmen? Or if Fatima radiallahu anh never kept watch over him while he prayed and would be harassed and assaulted in the haram? Though we may feel like we're on an island, whether as non-black immigrant Muslims or just Muslims in general, when we say Black Lives Matter in our homes and masajid, or call out our family members for using the N-word in casual conversation, or our masajid for wanting to do photo ops with police despite all that's transpired in the past 6 months, we must remember we are not alone. We've never been alone. We need only to open our eyes so that they may see, and our ears that they may hear, and our hearts that they might accept those who share in our struggle, whom we may have backgrounded previously, and who may not look anything like us or know us, yet who are ever present. And if there is still silent from these areas, we must remember that there is yet one most important among them, the one whom we maybe ignore the most, Ar-Rahman, Ar-Rahim, Malik al-Mulk, Dhul Jalali wal-Ikram, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala himself. And that indeed, wa huwa ma'akum, that indeed Allah is with us, always with us. It is no surprise, therefore, sisters and brothers, that amidst all of this, we find ourselves on the eve of Ashura, the 10th of Muharram, a most solemn day in the history of Islam. Though this event should bring us pain and sorrow when we reflect on the tragedies that transpired on it, we remember Karbala. We remember Abu Abdullah, Sayyid al-Shuhada, Imam Hussein radiallahu anh, and his fight and struggle and ultimate sacrifice against the corrupted systems of power at the time, despite the inevitable consequences. I don't find it to be any coincidence that as Muslims, we find ourselves once again in the midst of a resurgence on the conversation of systemic racism, white supremacy, police brutality, among other things, in any other month than Muharram. How often is it that those of us who are not Shia Muslim treat this month, especially like these first 10 days, like those of any other month, without giving even a little credence towards its sanctity or its essence. How many times do we ask ourselves year after year, what can we as Muslims do for any cause, and not even bat an eye when Muharram passes us by? What this shows is the shaky foundations we have for our own faith, and we look for existential answers out in the world, thinking our tradition and religion to be something dated and of no use to us for such a moment as this. Yet, as I mentioned, these answers have been in our tradition and teachings for well over a millennia, for such a moment as this. When we look for how we can find a voice to raise up to systems of power and ingrained structures of oppression, we reflect on the Prophet ﷺ, knowing the power of simply speaking a word of truth to injustice. When we fear whether joining a protest or demonstration in solidarity with our Black sisters and brothers will compromise our Islamic values, we reflect on the Prophet ﷺ leading a protest march to the Kaaba alongside the downtrodden of society, Black and white. When we think about how lonely we may be in a struggle, yet assume that no one around us is as woke as we are, we reflect on how the Prophet ﷺ built a movement, not just himself, a movement that changed the course of history with the help of women and men, outcasts and establishment, Black and white, rich and poor, recognizing the gifts that each of them possessed, no matter their difference, and in turn, making his movement truly revolutionary. When we fear the consequences of correcting those whom we love the most in error, we'd speak against them in anywhere else, but we remember the consistency of the Prophet ﷺ as he admonished his own closest companions, who would make racist remarks towards his black companions, regardless of how much he would love them. Lastly, when we fear what may happen to us if we are rebuked, rejected, arrested, or even killed for that which we may believe, we remember the shoes of the Prophet ﷺ filled with blood after being rejected from Taif. We remember the bloody bodies of Hussein, of Ali al-Askar, of Abbas, and all martyred and captive members of the Ahlul Bayt and their true supporters, who knew that it would be better to die on their feet standing up to injustice rather than to live on their knees as prisoners of complacency. Lagan simply provides us a comfortable medium through which we can visualize a most uncomfortable struggle. Yet, as these days of Muharram show us, there is nothing comfortable exoterically in going against the grain. There will be emotional and physical pain, wounds and scars, yet there will also be resilience and triumph, resistance and perseverance. As we stand on the eve of Ashura and the 10th of Muharram, let us remind ourselves that wherever we are, especially in the time we are in right now, in this struggle, in this month, every heart is like the battlefield of Karbala, and in this fight against injustice, and every day in this fight is like Ashura. As we enter the Ashura of 1442 AH and mourn the events of Karbala in 61 AH, let us remember the Ashuras and Karbalas of those which have passed before us, of Ferguson, of Minneapolis, of Kenosha, and so many others, that we may reflect. As in Karbala, in the end, good will triumph over evil. But let us reflect on whether our desire for action will triumph over our succumbing to complacency. Aqulu qawli wa hadha wa astaghfirullah li wa lakum. I say these words of mine and I ask Allah for forgiveness in any of wrongdoing of them. Alhamdulillah, alhamdulillah wa salatu wa salam ala rasulillah. Sisters and brothers, to briefly recap, we covered quite a diverse array of topics, each of which could merit a class, let alone a khutbah on its own, from Lagan to the Sirah to the Sunnah of resistance and standing for justice to the significance of this moment in time as Muslims and as Americans on the eve of the 10th of Muharram. We have much to reflect on, but what we must remember is that we are going to be overwhelmed. We're going to feel like we're in that sunken space where we can't get out. We can't be heard or we can't be seen or we can't move. But the fact that we do feel some discomfort with ourselves or with what is happening in the society around us shows us that we're moving in the right direction. If we would just find ourselves content or undisturbed by what all is going on, we definitely would be in the red. However, the first step in wanting to make a change or correct an injustice is to have that unsettling, discomforting feeling that something is not right and doesn't sit well with you. once you've acknowledged that, you know you're at least on the right track. It may seem cliche for when I or anyone else says the solutions to our dilemmas we may be having at the moment or the answers we are searching for are in our tradition, in the hadith, in the sunnah, in the Quran, but I challenge you to take another look. I challenge you to at least go back and read the difficult moments in the seerah. Those moments we probably glossed over in Sunday school and would probably never read as in depth into. Look into the moments of pain, the moments of resistance, the moments of overcoming. Look at the Prophet ﷺ, not as he was walking back from Taif, but when he sat down and the conversation he had with Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala after he was walking miles in his bloody shoes. Let's reclaim the seerah for ourselves, not as something that occurred at a specific moment of time, but something that has resonance year in and year out of our lives. To do so, you don't need to just continue to dive into various texts and struggle to connect the dots across a millennia. Rather, witness. Witness to that which is around you. Witness to the mediums that we have, to the channels that are existing, or to the events that are happening. Open your eyes to not just see the TV shows or movies that we might binge watch for popcorn value, but relate them back to your faith and to your traditions. What do they say? What do the events going on in our world today, as distant as they may seem from our own context, tell us about the true values that Islam and the Sunnah specifically champion? What is the parallel in a Black person in 2020 saying, "I can't breathe," and a Black person in 7th century Arabia saying, "Ahadun Ahad," while both are being asphyxiated by their oppressors? As Muslims, we are fundamentally called to be more accountable to ourselves and to the world around us than anyone else. Part of this accountability comes in recognizing that our Muslim identity isn't restricted to 5 times a day or just on Fridays, and that the affairs of the world or the struggles of those who may not look like us or believe like us are in fact relevant to us. As such, we are accountable to finding our Islam, finding God, and finding the values of our faith and of our Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam in a place where someone wouldn't think to find them. We are accountable to be agents of change, particularly in a time such as this. For the Prophet ﷺ had informed us then and now to stand for justice and to correct an evil with our hands, with our tongues, and with our hearts. Lagan can just be a movie, or it can be a metaphor for the Muslims seeking to find the values of their faith in action. The seerah of the Prophet ﷺ can be another book that sits on the shelf, collecting dust, or it can be the tools for the Muslims seeking to make a better world. And lastly, the first 10 days of Muharram can be a set of dates on a calendar only perceived to be relevant to Shia Muslims, or they can be a period of transformation for all of us, reminding us that every day in the struggle for justice is Ashura, and every struggle is Karbala, even if we may not see the struggle as our own. Indeed, إِنَّ اللَّهَ يُحِبُّ الْمُقْسِطِينَ, that Allah verily loves those who are and who strive for justice. In the words of Ali radiallahu anhu, your yesterday is gone and your tomorrow is doubtful. Therefore, value today and act as though you will not have a tomorrow. We ask Allah to make us among those whom Allah loves as muqsitin. We ask Allah to give us the strength of our beloved Prophet ﷺ and his beloved grandson Hussein radiallahu anhu, and we ask that we strive to be agents of change and that Allah facilitates this in such a time as this. Ameen. We ask Allah to accept the Fatiha of Jacob Blake's father for his son's recovery and for justice to prevail for him and all those who have been wronged, victimized, and murdered by those who claim to uphold justice. Ameen. We ask Allah to give hidayah to those of us Muslims who are struggling to find our place at this time, that we may become the Ansar for our Black sisters and brothers through this struggle. We ask Allah to hear the cries of the oppressed of the world, of the mustadafun, the abused and marginalized, that they may be granted patience, liberation, and justice amidst their suffering. Ameen. We ask Allah, grant us the consciousness and awareness to utilize this time of COVID-19, a time of much solitude, to be a time of reflection, recalibration, and action. Ameen. We ask Allah to alleviate all who may be suffering from the effects of this pandemic, physically, mentally, and economically, and to help us be facilitators of this alleviation. Ameen. And lastly, we ask Allah to always be with us, in this world and the next, in all our ups and downs, to forgive us of our shortcomings and our sins, and to guide us to the right path, the path of those whom Allah has bestowed thy pleasure, and not those who have incurred the wrath of Allah. ربنا تقبل منا انك انت السميع العليم ربنا اتنا في الدنيا حسنه وفي الاخره حسنه وقنا عذاب النار ربنا افرغ علينا صبرا وثبت اقدامنا وانصرنا على القوم الكافرين ربنا لا تؤاخذنا ان نسينا او اخطانا ربنا ولا تحمل علينا ولا تحملنا ما لا طاقه لنا به واعف عنا واغفر لنا وارحمنا انت مولانا فانصرنا على القوم الكافرين ربنا لا تزغ قلوبنا بعد إذ هديتنا وهب لنا من لدنك رحمة إنك أنت الوهاب اللهم صل على محمد وعلى آل محمد كما صليت على إبراهيم وعلى آل إبراهيم إنك حميد مجيد ربنا آتنا في الدنيا حسنة وفي الآخرة حسنة وقنا عذاب النار آمين جزاك الله خير
جزاك الله thank you Usama that's what a powerful message and a reminder. I can tell you personally, I needed that. I needed to hear that, to hear a call to action and your uplifting message, because it's these days are kind of dark. So with that, sisters and brothers, I want you to welcome, and I want to welcome Usama to the regular Khutbah rotation going forward. We thank you for your time and your words and your thoughts, Usama. So announcements coming up, starting tonight. Actually, tonight's going to be the last night of the Islam in Black America course. It's the course put on by Dr. Sherman Jackson from the Bayan Institute. We basically have gone through the past 8 weeks every Friday evening, along with this course, a evening discussion every week. So tonight will be modules 20, A, B, and C. So if you watch the videos, sign in. Even if you haven't watched the video, sign in anyway, and come in now and join the conversation. Tomorrow at 11 a.m. is a continuation of the summer story time. Tomorrow will be a continuation of the story, Tell Me About the Prophet Muhammad, sallallahu alaihi wasallam. That's 11 o'clock on Zoom. Remember to go to the website to find all the links to everything I'm talking about. Then tomorrow from 4 to 5 p.m. is the Wisdom Tea. It's a bi-weekly virtual gathering for the senior community, 60 plus. Basically a social gathering to get a chance to chat, learn, and support each other and stay connected. Everyone's welcome, free to attend, also on Zoom. Then monthly book club is back starting September 25th, 6:30 p.m. on Friday. Please register for that. The first book this month will be Laughing All the Way to the Mosque by Zarqa Nawaz. So you have a month to read that, and we'll go from there. All right, and that's it. So again, thank you, Usama. Everyone, thanks for being here. You guys can stay on and socialize a little bit to say hi to everyone. And we'll see you, inshallah, next week. And Jumma Mubarak.